we cannot argue with the authorities. No, sir, you are not allowed to touch over this property. No. FT is very clear that if any auditor comes, he can even take your document or your asset at the premises to his premises wherever he wants to for verification. So there is no like limits for the VAT audit for the tax purpose, for the VAT audit purpose only. So he will tell that, okay, sir, I'm taking this for the VAT audit.
It's not tax, it's a VAT, it's not tax, it's one. It's a VAT, sales added value. That's it. If I don't sell, I have nothing to do.
Exactly, you are very much right.
Yeah.
You are very much right. When something is already announced, then we have to abide by the law.
Or they are not for this step.
Maybe, yeah, of course, they might be looking for some additional taxes.
Yeah.
Definitely they are going to look for it.
Could be.
Okay, let's move to the next slide. The means used by FTA to inform about the VAT audit. How they are going to communicate that we are going to send you a notification, that we are going to come for audit. The notification they will send by post, your registered post, electronic email, posting on the premises of the taxable, maybe they are going to send you a letter here. Any other means as may be agreed by person and authority. So they will be using some sort of mode of communication to send you a notification. And they will not come without PR notification. What documents will auditor inspect? It's a very important thing. What auditor will be looking forward? Once a person subject to VAT audit has been notified, the auditor will visit the premises to perform the audit. For the purpose of conducting a tax audit, the authority or the VAT auditor may inspect the premises itself, the premises of the client, the person under audit, the documents available at the premises, the assets that are available in the premises, the accounting systems used by the person subject to the tax audit. They may inspect your accounting system as well. If the accounting system is generating a reliable report, it may increase their level of confidence of going to the audit. It can define the extent of substantive procedure, how deep they have to go for verification. If the system is generating reliable reports, it means the quantum of their sample might be reduced. Maybe they only focus on the system generated reports. So it is very much important that they might look forward for accounting system. Your accounting system should be very well, you know, managed, and the reporting should be accurate, as much accurate as possible as compared to their actual invoices. If the place of audit is a residence or part used as dwellings, the tax auditor shall obtain prior written consent of Director General for Residency Affairs, as well as permit from the public prosecutor to be able to enter the part of the premises where the premises or parts used are used as a dwellings. One thing we can conclude from this is that VAT audit will not only be taken on the official premises. If a person is working from home, tax auditor may approach your home premises to conduct the audit. But for that, he should have a special request from the Director General of Residency Affairs and Public Prosecutor. And the person residing can ask before he enters and ask for the identity. He will show you his notification, his permission, his card, or maybe he is accompanied by some CID or some other official which is reliant, which you can put a reliance over it. So the VAT audit can also be done on premises or on the official address of the company.
Fourth point, accounting system. That some of my clients, they are maintaining their reports in Excel only. So the
accounting system is only a system. It can be an Excel-based system. It can be an ERP. It can be an invoicing system. Anything which you are using. Excel is fine. You are using to file your returns. Now, what is the purpose? The purpose is that the data which was required to be reported has been reported accurately or not. So, if you meet that purpose, then it's fine. You're using Excel to meet that purpose, fine. You cannot, like this photographer thing, they have a small company, even management, they cannot afford huge ERPs.
Yeah.
They're using it. So that's fine enough, fair enough.
Will every organization that is registered for VAT will go through the VAT audit?
Any person who is either registered for VAT or not registered for VAT, either he's a legal person, like a company, or a natural person. An individual is exposed to the auditors.
I mean, he will not for sure will go for audit. I mean, the FTA will have to select few organizations or few people for the audit.
Yes, it will be. See, the audit is this audit is a risk based approach.
Yes.
They will identify out of their samples which of the people, which of the persons to audit.
So how will FTA identify these?
Is their criteria.
Okay.
We may be part of their sample, we might not be part of their sample. So it's upon their discretion which organization. Because of course when people are filing the returns, they have a whole statistical analysis. Which company is filing which returns, how many money, how much values are they putting. So they might extrapolate the data, they might shuffle the data.
So have you declared the procedures for selecting any of these?
Their procedures, in my information, haven't gone through any guidance which clarifies the basis of their selection for the audit.
Even person is not registered, he can be.
He is also subject to audit.
Okay. Remember this.
So, moving on to the third section, the scope of VAT audit. What is the scope of VAT audit? What does scope actually mean? Scope means what are those documents categorically required by the VAT audit? What are the documents they will verify? How they will verify? How much time will they take? What they can do? What are their jurisdictions? What are their authorities? Things like the scope. Scope of the VAT audit. As mentioned earlier, the VAT auditor will inspect the following: the premises itself of the person under audit, documents available at the premises, the assets that are available at premises, the accounting systems used by the person subject to the tax audit. When we talk about premises, this includes but is not limited to the branches, stores, head office, other VAT entities in case of a VAT group, and any other place which auditor considered needs a visit. It could be a warehouse, it could be a storage facility. For example, if I have, it could be a cold storage or a dry storage, I'm a generating company or any company, I cannot afford a warehouse, I have contracted with the third party logistics, I have kept my inventories there, so auditors may, by way of me, can reach there for tax audit. Documents available at the premises. Any document available at site under visit. The type of documents include but not limited to all the commercial invoices, your sales, your bills, purchases, expenses, your contracts, contracts with customers, contract with vendors, with employees, any sort of contract, tenancy agreements, your trade license, article of association, article of memorandum, certificate of incorporation, shareholder certificate, director certificate, whatever auditor considered necessary to view, he can view any document he wishes.
These documents are, I can understand, very important. But what's the point of inspecting premises and assets of the organization?
Okay, the thing is that actually you will be given the time for question and answer at the end of the session because it will derail the momentum. Anyway, since you have already put up the question, I should answer you. See, the purpose of visiting the premises is that it might be very much possible that the results you are furnishing, it may give an evidence that you have a big operations, and the small area might not be in that industry. Is not, for example, your manufacturing concern. You cannot not have 100 or 2,000 square feet for manufacturing. You might be having different sites, right? Where you have a plant and machinery, they might go there as well to check the input tax you claim on your machinery is accurate or not. If that machinery is really related to your industry, or you are just buying or taking taking the invoices to claim the input, excess input, it might be that you are claiming input against those machineries which are not existing. They might go to check the existence of your machineries. So there are particular, like there are several reasons which could be there for the purpose of visiting the premises.
Income, total income tax, this one, not that. Believe me, this is not the reason. Say.
Yes, sir. This is this is something.
It's not legal at all. It's not that.
This is how we have to, you know, to follow the regulations. See, the purpose.
You check if you have how many wives also.
Yeah.
And how many kids you have, or where they are. They might be having money also.
The assets that are available at premises. Authority can inspect any asset available at premises. cross-verify with the documentation, for example, including a purchase invoice or delivery notes and things like that. He has the power to remove and retain persons as necessary for the audit process, but he will provide the details of any document or asset he is removing or retaining. This is a very important thing. The authority or the jurisdiction of VAT auditor is very wide. He has the authority to take your documents to his premises. He has authority to take your asset, to retain your asset for some time. But whatever is he going to do, he will give you a notification or inform you before he takes that thing, whether it's a document, whether it is an asset. Accounting system used by a person subject to the tax audit. The auditor may inspect the system and its reporting in order to assess the reliability of the system generated reports. As I discussed earlier, as I told earlier, that accounting system is very important because that is the system you are using to based on which you are filing your VAT returns. If that system generated reports are enough for the auditor to rely upon, he might not go into very much further verification. And he might rely on the system generated reports. And he may take sample out of it, verify it, and finish the work. So if you have a system, it should be very much accurate. It should match exactly with the VAT returns you have already filed. Where an original document is provided to or inspected by a tax auditor at tax audit, during a tax audit, he may make copies of the document. He may remove the document for a period specified by the tax auditor for completion of his work or make copies of it during the removal period, provided that he notifies the person of such matter. See, he can make copies of it. Any person coming in the company, he has no authority to touch the documents. But when it comes to VAT audit, VAT auditor can take the document, he can make copies of it, he can remove the documents, take to his premises, there he can make copies, send back the originals or send back the copies, so whatever he wants, till the extent of VAT audit only. He will not use your documents for any other purpose. It is expressly stated in his notification that it is taking or removing such assets, such document for VAT purpose only. Where a document is removed or an asset is removed, the authority shall provide a record of what was removed within 10 business days from date of removal to any of the following: the owner of the document or the asset, occupation, tenant of premises in which the document or asset were removed, the person who has custody or control of the document or asset immediately before removal. What does it mean? In short, the person who owns the document or in charge of that document in that specific time or asset will be communicated by the authority within 10 business days that we are removing or we have removed this document. A person can be a legal person or a custodian for that asset. The premises from which the documents are removed may be a residential area, so tenant will be informed about that. And if it's official, a person whoever is in charge of the document will be communicated for that. The record for the removed or retained document or asset shall include the following: what the tax authority will inform for removing, the purpose of removing the asset or document that we are removing for the VAT verification only, nature of asset or document so removed, what is the nature of asset, what is the nature of document, is it a legal document, if it's a legal document, what sort of legal document, trade license, memorandum, contract, legal tenancy agreement, if it is a financial document, what sort of document, vendor invoice, sale invoice. So he will notify you whatever documents he is removing for VAT verification. The location where the asset or document is stored and conditions of storage. He will also inform that we are taking these documents or these assets to so and so location. In case you are required to make payments or to receive payments or any for further operations, you may contact that specific location to get those documents back for temporary basis. Maybe he give you copies back or he may keep the copies and give you the originals back. The period for which it is expected to be retained by the authority. So the authority should also inform that we are taking these documents for this much time period. Maybe he take for 2 days, 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month, whatever period he considers sufficient for audit purpose, he will define you in this notice. the authority shall have the power to mark asset for the purpose of indicating that they have been inspected, obtain and record information relating to the premises, assets, documents, accounting systems that have been inspected. Similarly, like other audits, VAT audit is also a sort of an audit. So when auditors come, they inspect the documents, they put their mark or they put their stamp, okay, verify. Similarly, VAT auditors will also have the same power that he can mark or put their mark on any document or asset which they have already verified as a part of the sample. So it is very much understandable that they will use the documents and put their stamps on your documents just to mark that this has been verified. Complying with the notifications. Where a person has been notified to provide information or documents, the person shall do so within the period specified and by means and in the form determined in the notification. What does this mean? This means that if auditors, back auditors, inquires you about some document or information which is not readily available and is not with you in the premises or the area under visit, you have to arrange those documents within the specified time period, which he will mention in the notification that you have to provide me in this much time these documents. So you have to furnish those documents. If you don't have, you have to justify those things. That's why it's not possible, the vendor is not in the country, whatever. If the auditor satisfied, it's okay. If not, you have to deliver the documents to the address they have mentioned in the notification. Where a notification requires a person to provide information or documents, this shall be submitted at any of the following places. Any place agreed upon between the person and the authority, the place determined by the authority, provided that this place is appropriate and used solely as a dwelling. In short, any place where both the parties are mutually agreed, then this place you have to deliver the documents or asset, he has to deliver those. Ensure that it is delivered timely. Once all the documents requested have been provided and the required inspection by the tax audit is complete, he will complete his audit process and report the person subject to audit. Once he is through with the audit verification, he is satisfied, he is not satisfied, whatever. Once his verification is complete, the audit process is complete. Once it is completed, he will give you an opinion or he will calculate any unreported due tax along with any penalties starting from the relevant quarters up to the date. And so this is what the scope and how the procedure or mechanism of VAT audit will work. Once the VAT audit is completed, once the inspection and the other procedures required for the VAT audit are completed, the auditor has to inform the results of the audit within 10 business days of the end of the audit. So you will be notified within 10 business days about the results of your audit. Where a person subject to the tax audit is notified of the results of the tax audit, he may request the authority to view or obtain documents and data on which the authority based his audit opinion or assessment. So there is an option to the person under audit that he may request the authority to furnish the basis of their opinion if he is not inconsistent or he doesn't agree with the results of the tax audit. So there is an option. Such request shall be made in writing or through such other form adopted by authority within 20 business days from the date of notice provided by the authority and shall provide the request information within 10 days in the following manner. A paper or electronic copy of document or data requested. The original document or data requested, if such documents or data belong to the person subject to tax audit who made the request. If I summarize this slide, it is very much simple that once audit is complete, they will give their opinion within 10 working days. I will review that opinion. If I agree, it's fine. If I don't agree, then I have an option to request the authority through same channel of communication that sir, I do not agree, can you please furnish us the basis on which to base our opinion? They will give you the basis and they may also inquire you for further verification. And that verification you have to furnish those documents within 20 business days and so on. So this way if the authority says that the opinion we have already furnished is fine, then you have to accept it. If still you are not agree, you can report to the special committee designed for the contentious matters under Federal Tax Authority. And that committee is directly under the Director General for Ministry of Finance and Federal Tax Authority. He will review your request, and whatever decision he makes will be the ultimate decision, and you have to follow. In my view, things will not be complicated because tax is a very simple, VAT is a very simple tax. 5% on sales, 5% on purchases.
5% sale over 5% what?
On purchases. If I'm purchasing some tax on my purchases, I'll be paying 5% tax on my purchases.
They'll give you that.
Yes. So the thing is
I thought you'd be 5% here and 5% here.
Yeah,
there is one question here.
Sir.
I have normal auditor. I have a free zone company, small company. I am the only everything there.
Sir.
Okay? I import land, this thing from China and sent to Jordan. Thank God I'm not subject for that tax here at all.
Out of scope, yes.
But he told me, the auditor, every 3 months, every quarter, you have to report your VAT yourself. I mean, but you don't mention that.
See, this presentation was solely for a purpose of VAT audit. I have already conducted the presentation on VAT returns, how to file VAT returns. So that is some separate subject. Today's lecture was only on the VAT, on the audit. That's it. But since you have already put up the question, so. See, if you are doing an out-of-scope supplies, you have to, if you are doing only
out-of-scope supplies. I have to report every quarter to them.
Yes.
Through auditor or direct through me?
No, you have a portal login, you have to open that portal,
yes,
given by FTA, and you have to file your return. There is no mandated requirement of any agent.
But I have both and what I have to give them, that's all.
Yes. You don't have to report your sales. Because you don't have to report your sales.
Why not?
Because it's all out of scope. Goods are not being entered in UAE. Your supply.
No, I need to say locally.
That's fine. If you have locally, you have to report yourself.
Yeah, that's
fine.
Yes. But I'm not registered at all even now.
That's fine.
I'm thinking to register, but you make it complicated. I'm becoming frightened now.
No. It's not complicated. It's not complicated. See, there's a very predefined criteria.
No, I tell you in Jordan, I have establishment in Jordan, and we have the tax and the VAT. And my company dealing with exempted VAT and tax. But it's reported every 2 months by my own accountant. He prepared and forwarded. If they have a doubt, they come and inspect.
Sir.
Not every time. For last 2 years, they never came to my showroom.
Same case can be here.
Can be here also.
Yes. If you are not under their sample companies, you will not go audit.
They may not come at all, huh?
They may not. There are millions of companies here, small companies. Even in one free zone, Sharjah Airport free zone, if you take the statistics, they are registered more than 300,000 companies.
Yes.
They have only open for residency purpose. So in mainland, you can, other free zones also. So everyone is exposed to audit. Is not required to be like under the audit.
Yeah, we'll need
so
it.
So it depends upon the federal authority.
But
whatever they choose.
The way you presented it, it's become horrible.
No, see, you can say, because this is inherent understanding of the UAE, right?
Yeah.
Whatever UAE launches something, people start getting into it.
I think the system is made by India and by the government.
Sir?
You said that if we have out of scope sales, sorry, I'm just asking that.
No problems.
This out of scope sales, we are not supposed to mention in the report. If we have out of scope sales only, but we have local purchase, so then local purchase will not be mentioned because we have out of scope sales only.
See, there is always the basis of something for claiming. If I am dealing in out of scope supplies.
Yes.
And if I do the same nature of transaction in UAE, it will be taxable?
Yeah.
In this case, any expense incurred, I can claim back.
Yeah, but I'm making only out of scope.
But if I'm doing out of scope flights, and if I do same nature of transactions in UAE, and if those will be exempted, then I cannot claim my income tax. So it depends upon the nature of transaction you are doing, that will define how much and what input tax you are subject to.
So the authority will audit your financial statements, like income statement and balance sheet, because you are mentioning assets.
See the contents mentioned in the decree law in the cabinet decision is of course the profit and loss, the balance sheet, and the expenses details, right? Okay. The other thing is that since you have already filed the returns, so the returns already filed will also be the form of basis of their verification. If you don't have the accounting softwares, you can use your Excel files to prepare the profit and loss accounts.
No, will they audit?
Yeah, of course they will audit. What was it? They will audit.
They will audit the bank. They will audit the accounts.
Bank statements. Yes, they will. They will audit the bank statements. They will check the vouchers, sale invoices, purchase invoices, their serials, their dates, tax values, values before tax, customers TRN number, vendors TRN numbers, everything like that.
Account receivables also.
Account receivables is part of a balance sheet item, so for that they might only restrict their area to sales. But they may come to the account receivables also. Because account receivables itself has nothing to do with the tax. The thing which is linked is the revenue. Because account receivables are generated from revenues.
So those are only invoices.
Even they can go for 2017, like
last VAT audit. VAT only introduced in 2018.
Yeah, that I understand. But some of the people, they issued invoices in the month of December to save the VAT.
Okay.
That they can ask for the 2017 invoices.
They make, when we go for audits, as an auditor, if I go somewhere, if I have my year is to audit 2018, I will definitely look at the last quarter of 2017 as well. If some balances are pertaining to 2017, maybe they have earned invoicing or old invoicing, offshoot balance sheet items. So these are things, so they may extend their procedures to previous year as well. But this is not specifically mentioned that they will inspect 2017 as well.
Okay, let me ask one issue now I am facing with my client. That in 2018, I have issued so many invoices with the basic pattern of the tax invoice, which there is the on the one hand side, you have the TRN number of your customer, the address, and the, his name. And on the other side, which is the right hand side, your name, your TRN number, and address. And I am using actually the QuickBook. And there is not any option that we can make the invoice in a columnar based, that in a row, you have to mention each item, the quantity, and then the net value of that item, and then the 5% VAT, and after that, the gross value of that item's value. So this kind of the invoice is not making by my software. So I'm using the given already built-in VAT invoice, which is only on the basis of the items. It is giving only the quantity and the
date, the without tax
language. The value of that
so if you are only dealing in standard rated supplies, if you are dealing only in standard rated supplies, that format is acceptable, because whatever is coming on the invoice is all subject to standard straight away 5%. So 5% mentioned at the bottom of the invoice, you're using QuickBooks, right? Okay, 5% at the bottom is sufficient enough to prove that.
Yeah, because it's in the end it is giving the 5%, then 5%
yeah,
there.
That's fine.
But now my customer is insisting, and he's giving the link with the Article 59, and he's saying that although they have accepted so many other invoices in 2018, but now they have changed their consultant, and now the consultant is insisting on only two.
Their consultant is.
Yeah, and my customer's consultant now, they are insisting that you have to make the invoices above than 10,000, exceeding the 10,000 maybe, in this pattern. So I have to convert myself into the Excel. So this is the problem with. Is it the interpreting? They are interpreting this article 59.
See, there is a regulation in executive regulations. There is such requirement. But if you are dealing in only one type of transactions, that is also acceptable the way you are doing it. One thing. The other thing is that if you are dealing in multiple transactions, you must contact your software vendor for each line of item having different rate, zero rate, or whatever. So
but
for
if,
this,
if there is a standard here,
if
well,
only standard
here,
there is no requirement to mention tax at in front of each line item.
But they are insisting and they are bonding me.
There is no such requirement. I have, at least I haven't gone through any such requirement, which particularly states you have to mention tax rate at each in front of each line item. It's not compulsory.
So
advisable, but not compulsory.
But I have read that in Article 59,
mm-hmm.
it is written over there, the exceeding 10,000. So what that interpretation?
Article 59 is on tax invoices.
Yeah, tax invoices.
Tax invoices, right? It states that.
In Section 5, there, in a B.
It states that the if the invoice is more than 10,000, it is compulsory to mention the TRN number of the customer you are issuing. It is compulsory to mention the TRN number of your company on the invoice. The rate you are using must be in dirhams. If you are using a foreign currency, the exchange rate of that particular date from the UAE official exchange rate, UAE Central Bank website must be mentioned their exchange rate, and the AED dirhams specifically written there. The amount before tax, the tax value.
I'm doing
and it should be headed with a tax invoice header. Only these seven elements have to be there. If you are following this, sufficient and appropriate for tax invoice.
So
there is no point of going into depth or entertaining anyone's question.
Yeah, it means that they are misinterpreting this.
Up to them, I cannot comment on
it. There is a question here. When you import something to Jabal Ali, this is the government take VAT direct on that VAT. Why?
See,
I don't sell yet.
You don't sell yet. See, output tax, there is a definition of output tax. There's a definition of output tax liability. It is not only on your sales. Output tax liability is on your sales, your imports,
uh-huh.
and your zero rated supplies. But when the fortunately the zero rated supply is with a zero rate, but you have to file in your output section. So if you are importing something, they will charge your tax.
Why that?
But if it's their declaration,
uh-huh.
They run on a presumption that if I am importing something, if I don't import and buy locally, I have to pay 5% tax.
Yes.
Right. When it comes to imports, this states that you should go under reverse charge mechanism. This is special terminology. I will not go into attachment detail, but it says that if you are importing something, you will be levied with 5% tax. And if it is a your business import and not a private import, you can claim that back immediately in same quarter if
when
it
when you sell it to somebody.
If you once you sell that product.
When you sell it you can't reclaim that.
When you sell that you can claim that back from the parties. So if you are selling in same quarter it will not give rise to your
if
cash.
Not sold in the same quarter, sold after 6 months or
see this thing is in very much grey area.
That's
because
very nice.
Yes. No, the thing is that when you are importing something, when something you are importing and you cannot define a measurement basis for that, and you are using it for manufacturing or repackaging something and then selling to you cannot define the value of the import which has been used in this quarter's sales. So if you think that it is your business purchase, so you can on a reasonable grounds put it as same quarter as a reverse charge. You don't need to pay any tax on import.
But doesn't say it's stuck there in Jabal Ali for 1 year.
There's no point of stocking in something if you are very much
for it as well for 90 days. And otherwise, you have to pay the import fee.
For 90 days criteria?
Yes.
90 days only.
The 90 days criteria. If it's more than that,
Excel. Suppose I have visa under company A, can I assist the audit of company B?
Yes.
You can assist on a freelancing basis. Or company
no, like
B
it's in the group of the
contract.
Companies or for the family members.
See, no, it's not like you cannot be very much casual about it. If you want to render your services, there must be a contract between company
no, like
A
and I'm working there. Suppose the family, they have a lot of companies. I have visa under company A. If the auditor come, can I assist the company B? The audit of the company B?
You're not allowed to do that.
Ah, okay.
You must have a contractual agreement between company A and B. If A wishes the employees on his visa to render services on part of company A only, not in the personal capacity, on the company A, and it should also have that activity in the license also, in order to allow him to do such activity. Only then you can go ahead, otherwise,
this audit can be surprising or
they will notify you 5 days before the
yes.
5 working days. You can take it as a week.
If company is supplying any services which is not mentioning the trade license, then is there FT any problem?
It's more like a legal question, not a right question. Anyways, you are not allowed, but if you are doing something like that, you should.
FTA has any problem with FTA needs only the VAT because the company can't properly bear.
FTA can inspect any document. They can do anything.
Document is okay.
Yes, please, but please bear in mind that all authorities are all these yes, Ministry of Finance is heading these authorities.
Yeah.
So they have a very wide jurisdiction area. If they come up with something, if they cannot find anything related to VAT and they are really want to put something over you, they can take a license and put something over you.
They have given the authority.
It's not only in UAE, even if you go to other jurisdictions, that's something that they are not practicing there. But it is genuinely, if you are not allowed to do something, you shouldn't do that.
Yeah.
If you have any queries, any questions.
If you have nothing in your hand, any assets, paper which is showing you are proving the historical cost of that particular asset,
mm-hmm.
So what will you?
If there will be a historical one, there's one question which I can answer is there won't be any VAT on that, and you haven't claimed the VAT on that, and that's the reason you won't. Maybe you can incur the normal expenses on day to day basis,
yes.
But you haven't reclaimed your input VAT on that.
It's very unpractical that you're claiming something you don't have the documents.
I have a question. Is this VAT audit opinion supposed to be published in the financial statements?
In my audits, in my claims, I do verify the VAT liabilities and expenses, and I put a special note on it.
Under the statutory audit?
In my financial audit. Whether it is a statutory audit, whether it is an audit, like a discretionary audit, because some free zones do not require audits. Some mainland also do not require audits. So whenever I do audit, I do special consideration for my purpose, and I put my disclosures on VAT.
So if in the statutory audit, if the VAT audit have already been done, so why need to
go? VAT audit, see, statutory audit is appointed by the shareholders of the company.
Yes.
It's not appointed by the government.
But
VAT audit is a government audit. So it's same like you have income tax in your income tax audit in your company, in your countries. They come, they are not your auditors,
mm-hmm.
They are government auditors. It's same like that. It's government audit.
So will they can they check your software also?
Yes.
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 They can't touch your laptop even there.
And so they will notify us upon completion
yes.
That
this is a reference.
Yeah, they can't check your laptop.
36 exact regulation accounting system.
Mm-hmm.
Sir.
Upon completion, the FTA will notify the audit is completed and we will notify
within 10 working days.
Days.
They will give you a report.
Hey, upon completion, they will notify that within 10 working days we will inform you about our opinion.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
If you're in a VAT refund position,
okay.
Does the FTA get back to you like after every quarter once you've submitted the return? Or how does it work?
VAT refund is very like, before it was a little problem, but now it is very in line. Whenever you file a refund, they will review that refund request. They will send you some documents
okay,
for
so
each refund file.
Okay, what has happened is we submitted return for 3 quarters.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't hear from the FTA,
mm-hmm.
But as of 31st December, we got an email stating they need the details of it. So is this a VAT audit or is it just like a normal procedure that
happens? It depends how they communicate it to you. If it is in response to the VAT refunds, that is only the VAT refund.
It's a VAT refund.
So it is VAT refund.
And is there a time limit to get back to the authority? I think it's 5 days.
They have mentioned in their email that within 5 working days you have to mention, you have to declare them. They might have also attached one Excel file.
No, I mean, so the email that we got had no Excel file, but then obviously when I go to FTA link, there is a file which we need to download.
On the VAT refund,
yeah?
Refund.
But then there was no limit of working days that you need to get back to them. So
usually it is 5 working days, but if they haven't mentioned, follow the business practice, which is 5 working days, or whenever you end up with the working, send them on the same email, revert with the same email, send them the file.
Okay, so ideally after every VAT return, if you are in a refund position, you're supposed to get this email from the FTA.
You're supposed to get, but if you don't get, you can go directly to the VAT refund request. From there, you can file your refunds. Once you file your refunds,
mm-hmm.
if they put your notification, send you email, then you move ahead. Otherwise, you can, you from your side also follow up for the request.
From our side, follow up as in, sorry?
On info@tax.gov.ae.
Yeah, but they don't get back, like...
This is how it works. You are talking about refunds. In the first 5 months, this call center of the FTA was also saying, when we put up some query, they were saying, sir, please refer law, refer law, refer law.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
So,
yes.
Referring law, I can also refer law. I've been referring for a long time, but there is some... This is how it is working. It will be improved. They're improving. They're really declaring a lot of things, new things now. So I believe that they will come up with something which is everyday, everyone's requirement. So if you don't get any email for against any refund, follow yourself. Because a lot of my, almost all of my clients are getting refunds in the bank.
They ask for that IBAN validation. Like
IBAN validation letter.
And then they ask for that FDA updated this new one. Earlier there was one format and they have updated the format. And then you attach the documents. And certainly they don't agree the person name invoices. If some, I have one case pending with FDA, there's this real estate developer. He has invested around 40 million and he has around 2 point something refund. And they are not actually giving him the refund because of one invoice from there which is on his name. Not on the company's name, and they always not changing the name on the name, updating the name and the DRM on that.
Now, there's not a lot to be claiming.
Whoever
is a personal name, no?
Yeah, definitely.
But if TRN number is mentioned, then?
Then even they will process. They will process.
Who's TRN number?
The company's
TRN number is mentioned. Even there wasn't the personal name.
I haven't come across much, but if you're saying it's in the company, in person name, but that TRN
number
is
mentioned, then they will
accept. Yeah, TRN is the company's name. But they have given the documents of like that and everything, but still, there is no...
Once something goes into pending, then just...
No, they have just reviewed it again and again. They have sent the queries. There are invoices of huge amounts, around 20 million invoice something. And there are a few invoices which are of 15,000 and 60,000 just only the tax. They have reviewed those and they haven't committed only. Just only this one, they have just said that it's under this name and then there is a bank. And there is no communication after that.
Try if you can get those invoices replies from the vendor.
I have done one.
They will do it.
They have done it, but not the Deva. Actually, the client is not here.
Deva is
the client is not here, and the guy is not having the DOA, who is the authorized representative here. And he cannot change it in his case.
Deva is from the official premises?
Yeah, official.
And that office premises is under the company's tenancy?
No. The developer's place where he is developing the land.
Huh.
And that place, they have actually registered on his
personal name
and not on the company's name with the company TRN and everything. The rest of all the invoices got updated with his company name and company TRN, but not that they have still with the, it's around 1 million.
And he's filing the return for the company.
He's filing the return for the company because actually the whole land is for the
belongs to him.
It belongs to him and he's developing, I think, 110 million is the total amount.
Thank you very much for coming and attending the session. If you have any query, any question, you can drop your emails or queries on the reception as well. You can take the my card also, and you can contact us on these details.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Requested for a VAT refund, obviously, because the guidelines were not in place. But now, they've come back with questions like that. So